Tosca, Puccini's Tosca. Never was there a more tightly packed barrel of bang for the buck than Puccini's opera. In scarcely 2 hours of music, we have two lovers, one serious bad guy, political turmoil, marvelous music, and two murders, two suicides, an attempted rape, and a torture scene. It all goes by quickly, but it is well worth exploring the delights and the drama of Puccini's Tosca. Ideally in a live performance, but a recording will do if that's what it takes. This is certainly an opera for the ages. Whence Puccini's Tosca? We can thank the French playwright Victorien Sardou, who was the star of the Parisian stage in the latter part of the 19th century. He wrote some of his plays specifically for the talents of Sarah Bernhardt, and Sardou's La Tosca was exactly that. It has to do with an opera singer, her artist lover, and the evil police chief, police superintendent, whatever you wish to call Scarpia. That's who he is. He's the bad guy, and he wants to bring down both of them, as long as he can first get Tosca to himself. That's the story as Sardou tells it. And that is the story as it comes to Puccini. It is an opera, or a play, with very specific time setting, because there's a reference in it to the Napoleonic Battle of Marengo, which took place on June 14th in 1800 in far northern Italy, just a bit west of Verona. That's part of the political conflict that comes up in the play and the opera. Sardou's play premiered in Paris, November 24th of 1887, with Sarah Bernhardt in the leading role, title role, Tosca herself, the opera singer with not just a heart of gold, but a spine that is not to be broken. At its Parisian premiere, the audiences adored Sardou's La Tosca. The critics, however, were far more skeptical. They apparently were insensitive to the drama of the story. They simply declared it to be vulgar and immoral. But the more the critics shouted about it, the more the audiences wanted to see it. It was a massive success. What made it work? Sardou had crafted an exciting, dramatic, and powerful story, and Sarah Bernhardt in the title role could not have been bettered. As for Puccini's Tosca, that comes straight out of Sardou's. Puccini saw a performance of the stage play in Milan, in French, with Sarah Bernhardt in the leading role, and was blown away by the drama, the gripping energy of the piece. He insisted to his publisher, "You must get me the operatic rights to the story." And through various twists and turns and a bit of underhanded dealing, his publisher, Ricordi, which is still in business, did obtain the rights, and Puccini set to work. For Tosca, he brought together the same creative team that he had worked with 4 years earlier on the mega-hit La Bohème. The other two gentlemen, Luigi Illica and Giuseppe Giacosa, would be in charge of the words that would be sung, to take the stage play and turn it into an opera-quality libretto. Singable phrases, tighter drama, keep the story moving, make it happen. The three of them together brought their own ideas to how to adapt Sardou's script into operatic form. They brought it to the stage in Rome, had to be in Rome because that's where the settings of the story are, and it premiered on January 14th, 1900, 6 months short of 100 years after the Battle of Marengo, which is mentioned in the opera and in the play. The reception for Puccini's opera from the first was rather like that of Sardou's original play, that the audiences thought it was fabulous and bought tickets to performance after performance, and the critics said, "It is shocking, it is scandalous, it does not deserve a place on the stage." The audiences won, and Tosca became a mega hit for Puccini. It has been said of Tosca that it is all prose and no poetry, and that was said of it by one of the librettists, Giuseppe Giacosa. There is plenty of prose. There's a lot of drama and excitement and a lot of words to make them happen. But the poetry is there as well, provided by Puccini, and especially evocative in the personalities of the three central characters to the story, and how Puccini, in his music, makes us care deeply about two of them and detest the third. Let us meet, musically speaking, the three main characters of Tosca. In the order of vocal appearance, Mario Cavaradossi comes up first. He is the tenor of the cast, and he is a fine art painter, currently engaged in painting a mural of Mary Magdalene for the church San Andrea della Valle in Rome. It's a real place. It's there now. And it was certainly there in Puccini's time. Mario, working on this mural, reflects to himself as to how he has managed to make Mary Magdalene look rather like his own sweetheart, the opera singer Floria Tosca, whom we shall meet before too much longer. So Mario is a painter and a lover. He is not much involved in politics until the moment when a friend of his comes storming into the church looking for sanctuary. This friend is a political revolutionary and needs somewhere to hide. Mario helps out, thus getting himself involved in politics, and it doesn't turn out too well for him in the long run. However, in the short run, Tosca is about to arrive to visit him. Tosca is an opera singer, dramatic, flamboyant, and strongly emotional. She declares her feelings to her beloved Mario. She declares her feelings against the evil Scarpia. She even declares her feelings to God when her life is seeming to take a darker turn. She sings to God, "I have lived for art. I have lived for love. Why is this happening to me?" Tosca would not be having dark reflections upon her life were it not for the bad guy in the piece, Scarpia, the evil police chief, who is using his position of power to have his way with the world and to hope to have his way with Tosca. Even before Tosca herself realizes that his evil eye is fixed upon her, Scarpia has been making sure that the audience knows this fact, standing in the same church where Mario quite recently had been working on his painting, and declaiming boldly, "Ah, Tosca, you make me forget God." Each of the three acts of Puccini's Tosca takes place in a specific setting in Rome, a building that existed in Puccini's time and in our time. Act 1 is in the Church of San Andrea della Valle. Act 2 is in the Palazzo Farnese, where Scarpia has his offices. Act 3 is at the Castel San Angelo. Puccini made a great point of reflecting those specific locales in his music. As a former church organist, Puccini knew that in different regions of Italy, different versions of the Te Deum would be sung in prayer. So he wrote to the music director of San Andrea della Valle to inquire about what form they used, and that's what we hear the church choir singing in Act 1. Moreover, he asked the music director what pitches were the bells in the church tower, and he has those pitches ring as bell tones. The last act of Tosca is set in the Castel San Angelo, right across the river from the Vatican, therefore not far at all from St. Peter's. Puccini wrote to the music director at St. Peter's to ask about the pitches in their bell tower and to inquire especially as to what was the lowest pitched bell that they possessed, because he wanted to use that tone in the last act. And we shall hear it, a very low pitch to sound dark, somber, and perhaps a bit sinister, as the story is beginning to take a grim turn for our leading couple. If one wished to see these specific locales, there is a marvelous filmed version of Tosca that made a point of filming each of the acts separately in those locales, with Act 1 at San Andrea della Valle, with Act 2 at the Palazzo Farnese, with Act 3 at the Castel San Angelo. The film was made in 1992, but is still widely available. Placido Domingo is Mario, the tenor role. Catherine Malfitano performs Tosca, and Ruggero Raimondi is the Scarpia in that production. It's worth looking for. However, even more worth looking for is a live performance on stage with the performers, the sets, the costumes, the music, and all of the drama right there in front of you for Puccini's Tosca. The opera had premiered on January 14th of 1900, over a century later. It is still one of the most frequently performed of all operas. For one, it's by Puccini, and his craftsmanship is not to be doubted. For two, it's a relatively short opera with a high amount of drama that appeals on many levels. There is also the fact that the story itself, in its essence, is something that can reach to us even today. A vital and passionate leading lady, her beloved sweetheart, drawn into circumstances beyond his control, but doing what he can to do the right thing, and the evil force that oppresses them and that they hope to outwit. It is a story that is timeless. It is not just of 1900 nor of 1800 when it is set. It is a story that can always speak to one, especially with Puccini's magnificent and touching music for Tosca, for Mario, and even for Scarpia. He's a bad guy, but he gets some good tunes as well. Puccini's Tosca, glorious and gripping, whether it's one's first time or one's 20th time, Puccini's Tosca is not to be missed. It will get to you in the most satisfactory and fulfilling fashion. I'm Betsy Schwarm. Thank you for joining me. As soon as you have a chance to see Tosca, take it in.